to anxiety rather than some sort of conduct or ADHD. So just sort of keep that in mind when you're working with this child. And so what do we do here when that happens? So the first thing is, just to go back to what we were talking about earlier, just to say, don't do that, which I think is everyone's first impulse. It's actually keeping that, it's increasing the anxiety to say, you know, don't tap on your pencil, don't tap your foot. Because then even if they stop tapping, the thought is still going to be in their head and they don't have that release for it anymore. So we want to help them to postpone their behavior by distracting them if possible. So this is tough because you guys are in a classroom with however many students and you can't always just focus on that one student. What you can do, if you notice that they're engaging in any of those fidgety behaviors, you can ask them a question. So-and-so, start reading now. Or so-and-so, can you answer this question for us? Again, pick 5 seconds. So help them to postpone if it's possible. The other thing is, just to talk briefly about the idea of the anxiety monster. We have the kids, when they come in, label their anxiety monster. And that way, they're able to sort of differentiate, okay, the anxiety monster is not necessarily who I am. So many of these kids, their self-esteem is so low because they've completely identified themselves on the same level as their anxiety, and it's hard for them to distinguish what is the anxiety kicking in and what is the real me here. And so they just think that they're this weird person that's stuck with anxiety and always feeling that all those physiological symptoms of the fight or flight. So we want to try and have them label, okay, this is the anxiety monster right now. This isn't you. And take a step back. Again, is this a saber-toothed tiger that we need to be worried about? Or is this the anxiety monster playing a trick on you? Is this actually a cute, cuddly kitty cat that you're thinking is a saber-toothed tiger? So by asking them, okay, is this the anxiety monster right now? Or is this really you? Or is this the anxiety monster playing a trick on you? It can pull them outside of where they were at, which is right in this tornado of being overcome by the anxiety. It's a way to just pull them outside. And it also gives them some control over the situation, which a lot of times what's so scary for them is they feel like they don't have any control. Something's just overtaking them. Okay, and so if those things don't work, we can encourage the student to step outside, take a break, and just reframe it again. This is the anxiety monster's needs right now. These aren't your own needs. You can take a break, you can think this over, and then you need to come right back into the classroom. Okay, and again, we can't put pressure on that child to stop engaging in whatever behavior they're engaging in, because it doesn't work. Unfortunately, even though they may or may not be able to stop that behavior, it's going to send those thoughts. They're only going to escalate. And so they won't be able to concentrate any more than they were beforehand. So if they can't stop the behavior, then we can't force them to. So how many of you guys have kids that will ask, it can be tricky, I'm wrapping it up, we're really close to finish, but this can be tricky, the idea of reassurances where there actually is a form of their anxiety, this need to know, asking the same question over and over and over again, versus asking a question where they really don't know the answer. So do you guys have a sense of distinguishing between the two? Okay, I see, that's good. So a child with anxiety, what do we do when it's actually part of their anxiety? It is it's a behavioral manifestation of anxiety. If you're asking the same question over and over again, either the same exact question or the same question worded in a different way, that is their need to know and to get things just right. So am I supposed to answer only the odd questions? You can answer their question, if that's their question they're putting to you. Answer it once, in case they really didn't hear the first time, or really don't know. And then when they start asking a whole bunch of follow-up questions, do not answer. Give ambivalent responses instead, such as, I think you know the answer to that, James. Or they ask again, okay, well, do whichever questions you feel inclined to answer, and then when we go through the grading, we'll figure it out. We're about to review these, do the problems. Just give some sort of ambivalent answer without actually responding yes. 1, 3, 5, 7.
Why is that?
We want to give them ambivalent answers because the more that we're feeding into the anxiety and it's turning into a vicious cycle, we're stuck in the cycle.
You have to remember, again, it's uncertainty that drives anxiety, right? So by giving you ambivalent responses, what we're doing is exposing you to that uncertainty so that you get used to uncertainty. Because nothing is certain in this world except for death and taxes. Right? Okay. So in essence, that's what we're doing, exposing them to the ambivalence.
Okay. So here's some potential accommodations. I want to talk about these kids with severe test anxiety. One thing would be to give them non-traditional tests. So to take a test orally rather than on paper, to have them complete a project rather than a traditional sit-down test, if that's an option. It may not be. So it depends on how much flexibility there is within your grading system. Also, breaks during testing can be helpful. Extra time can be helpful. What you'll find, the extra time is helpful, especially if they don't wind up using it all. So going back to someone over there that asked the question initially, if a child has anxiety, it's sort of like a comfort that they've got this extra time because it's not something that they're constantly worried about, that's constantly on their mind, like, how much time do I have, so they can't focus on the task at hand. So that's how extra time can be helpful. If they wind up just ruminating and using all of that extra time, it may be not as helpful as an accommodation. Okay, writing directly into the test booklets rather than transferring their answers. Again, that's getting really caught up in did I transfer this correctly and spending a lot of time on doing it that way. Okay. So I want to stress here that the writing anxiety, writing compulsion, this may or may not be coupled with a writing disorder. So what we're talking about here, we can even assume that the anxiety about writing is not related to a writing disorder. So this could be, again, with the blackboard. Am I getting absolutely everything down exactly right to make sure that I can review it and know exactly what the teacher meant? So one thing they can do is tape record the lessons. If it's an option for you, and again, these are just some suggestions, it's up to you, to give them an outline of the lesson notes or have them work with another student to compare their notes with the other student's notes. And that can be good because it can also foster a buddy system, improve their self-esteem that way. And just, again, non-traditional, have them submit their assignments on tape or have them type their assignments. And again, someone was saying, what do? Tell them to get a B? I forget, it was somebody back here. What do I do? Tell them to get a B? Well, one thing you could say is there's not going to be any deduction for sloppy handwriting. There's not going to be any deduction for misspelled words unless it's a spelling test or something, you know, or where they're learning script. When appropriate, just to ease that level of anxiety and focus on, you need to show that you've learned the material, not that everything about this is perfect. Okay, and then finally, last slide. Same thing with reading compulsions. This could or could not be associated with a reading disorder. So a big thing, especially if this is anxiety about reading and getting everything just right and not necessarily a reading disorder, have them read through it only once. Because what they'll find is they can read through it only once and they still get all of that information the same way. Answer that math question in a split second, you're still going to get it right. even though you didn't have the extra time to double and triple check it. So have them read it through only once. Again, breaking down that mountain into little molehills. 50-page paper, give them, break it down into smaller increments, or help them to schedule in their planner. And again, non-traditional books on tape, recording the reading materials. Okay, so that's it for the PowerPoint portion of the presentation. I know that we're late on time, so
any questions? Okay, well, I thank you all. If you do have questions, you know, you can come up.
I know there's PACEGA review forms, and then also we have our own, so we know what to do for next year. So you can just put those on the chair right here.
I have a question for you.
Sure.
What do you do with somebody who has